comments. My name's Daniel. It's great to see some familiar faces after meeting last year at the expo, and some new as well. And I think a couple of you I've recognized from the river too. Before we start, really fast, it's always good to know where we're kind of launching off of. Like, has anybody here ever heard of or familiar with the Wildlife Federation? A couple people. That's great. Not always the case. How about salmon and steelhead fishing? Do we have active salmon and steelheaders in the room? Okay, cool, even better. Just a really quick background on who we are and kind of why we're here giving this talk. Besides being personal anglers ourselves, steelhead and salmon, the Wildlife Federation's been around since 1936. So we're the state's oldest and largest. It's a coalition of sporting groups. We represent 29 groups, much like yourselves, from around the state. And our mission is to look out for the well-being of fish and wildlife populations, hunting and fishing, public lands, and access to said public lands. So easy way that I like to boil it down is to imagine that we try to position ourselves at the table, speaking for sportsmen, hunters and anglers around the state, anywhere where the public and the private sectors, or I'm sorry, the government and the public sectors kind of intersect, and represent the voice of sportsmen there, bringing in the voices of those 29 groups for the well-being of our mission. So really happy to talk to you guys today. We really focus on, specifically Dan, focusing on those riverside communities and the angling community here in Boise, could be an essential voice in that this conservation campaign that's been going on for damn near almost 70 years, if not more. So really excited. I'm going to hand it off to Garrett, who oversees IWF's conservation programs, and he's going to kind of take it away and talk to you guys, and then we'd love to hopefully have a bunch of room, and we're here to volley questions and answers, and I think that's one of the most valuable parts of any of these conversations. And personally, as the comms guy, if there's any questions that any of you leave with, or if you get home and you're having a conversation trying to talk about what we talked about today, there's a sign up in the back on that little green book there. It's free. We do not do a membership. We are open for public consumption. We're here to serve sportsmen for the state, and we'd love to have you guys sign up just to give us a shot, to try us out, to absorb the information that we work hard to put out for you guys. So thanks again for having us.
Man, you can really tell the comms guy is. He has the whole pitch down. thanks for having us. My name's Garrett Visser. Like Daniel said, I work for Idaho Wildlife Federation and conservation programs. Came on about 4 years ago now, and this has really been a major focus of the Federation. We're a staff of five, and this campaign really touches on each five staff members' duties and our role in the campaign. So really excited to talk to you guys today. I'm going to try to move quickly through this. It's a lot of information, and it's by far, it's in no way a comprehensive kind of look. So I'm gonna try to whiz through it, but provide you guys with enough of the boilerplate, get into some specifics in each area. But again, I'm gonna try to whiz through it so I'm not boring you guys and we go over an hour. So I'll try that. So theme of tonight is Northwest in transition. So I'm gonna walk you guys through a number of things. The first is Idaho salmon and steelhead, their current status, how we measure adult returns, and how they stack up against other populations throughout the Columbia River Basin. That's really important as we talk about sinker issues. We'll talk about what's actually killing our fish. We'll go into a little bit of a transition into a background on the Bonneville Power Administration. Important player in this whole equation. And then we'll dive into a brief overview of Representative Simpson's Columbia Basin Initiative that he announced and put forth to the public in February of 2020. COVID times, it's difficult to remember the years now. So, but yeah, that's the general layout. So we'll dive right into the fish side of things. So salmon steelhead, I think we all know, provide a significant importance to Idaho, but there's also a significant importance of Idaho when we're looking at the Columbia River Basin as a whole. The Snake River Basin, which includes the, you know, the Salmon and the Clearwater, they all join meet the Snake just about on the border of Idaho and Washington. The Snake River Basin historically produced about 55% of summer steelhead and 40 or 45% of spring and summer chinook to the entire Columbia River Basin. It's a huge powerhouse producer historically, and it's not that way today, but that's what it was back in the day. But like I said, there's a significant importance of these fish to our state economically. There's about $100 million spent pursuing these fish annually. Provides about 2,000 or more rural jobs. As Daniel was saying, a lot of our work is focused in these very rural riverside communities, and they have a significant, you know, disproportional impact to those communities. So it's very, very important that we keep those fish around for the livelihood and the economic, you know, well-being of those rural communities. So just as an example of that economic importance, Chinook fisheries can generate up to $90 million a year, just those Idaho riverside communities. The 2001 spring Chinook season, which is a particularly good year in returns, that brought an estimated $10 million to Riggins alone, where the estimated total spending that year was $44 million. We're just talking about one spring summer Chinook season, so about, you know, roughly 3 months, bringing in a quarter of the total annual spending in that little town of 400 people. So pretty significant importance. But also there's a flip side to that equation. In 2019, there was for I think the first or second time ever, there was a complete closure of the Clearwater River steelhead season for anything. There's been closures on harvest, but this was a total fishing closure on the Clearwater River. The economist estimated that there was about a loss of $8.6 million a month to the Clearwater region. And that closure was pretty much from November through early spring. So a huge loss on the flip side of things. So again, it's just really important that we keep these fish around, not only for Idaho's identity, you know, as those riverside communities, but also just those people in those riverside communities. It's really, really important.
Are you gonna get into why it was closed?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it was just a simple thing of not getting a broodstock back. I'll get into broodstock. I'll get into a little bit of the difference of wild and hatchery fish, but we have to have a certain number of returning hatchery adults to actually generate the next whole cycle for those hatcheries, and we just did not have enough coming back. There's also other things at play when you have lower returns of hatchery fish. You have an increase on the increased fishing pressure on those wild fish, and we only have a certain amount that we can actually have a little bit of incidental take of mortality on that, so it also increases that. But I'll get into a little bit of it. So get into a little bit of the status of our wild salmon steelhead. As of the late 1990s, all of Idaho's wild salmon steelhead stocks were listed under the Endangered Species Act as either threatened or endangered, sockeye being the one that is endangered. And despite the protections that the Endangered Species Act provide, and spending more than $18 billion total over the years to recover these fish and mitigate for the loss of these fish, our wild fish returns are hovering at or below those numbers at the time of listing. So that is indicated by that left graph there. You've got the table from the 1950s to about present today, and you've got dam construction era from the 50s to the 70s, and you can see there in the 90s where we were about rock bottom, when the Endangered Species Act protections came into place. Had a few spikes throughout the years, but as you can see, historically we are trending downward, and we are pretty much scraping the bottom of the barrel for historical abundance terms. If you look at that right table there, this graph here, it's a little bit muddy, but this is a numerical chart that that has a low-level listing, or excuse me, low-level goals that we use, that we could use to delist these fish from the Endangered Species Act and give those federal protections. That's noted by that middle column there. The more important goal is the recovery goal, which is adopted by the Columbia Basin Partnership, which are stock numbers that represent, you know, truly healthy and harvestable levels. That is the ultimate goal. We want to get to those, you know, abundance levels that we can actually not have to worry about just scraping the bottom and just barely removing these fish off the Endangered Species Act. So when you compare it to the historical abundance, like I was saying, where the Snake River Basin contributed half of our total fish to the Columbia Basin total, when you compare those, even the Columbia Basin Partnership goals are just a fraction of what we once had. So we aren't even meeting any of the lower level ESA delisting goals today, and we're certainly not even getting close to those recovery goals identified by the Columbia Basin Partnership. So we're looking at a fraction of a fraction of a fraction of our total historical abundance. So it's kind of a bleak thing when you look at these percentages. Sorry, this might be a little bit tough to see, but you know, I touched on it very briefly, but we can fish for these fish largely because of the production of captured fish. These fish were put in the system to mitigate for the loss of wild fish when the dam construction era was going on. There was an act of Congress that actually mandated that we produce captured fish to make up for that loss in recreation value and some for conservation. But it's important to note that hatchery fish don't actually contribute towards those ESA delisting criteria goals. So a little bit tough to see, but when you combine, just when you combine wild and hatchery fish numbers total, we aren't even meeting the ESA delisting criteria goals most years. So showing that even if we, you know, pump the rivers full of hatchery fish, and we can, you know, feel good about ourselves of getting more fish in the river, that's actually not contributing towards an actual recovery of a species and a population because they're not wild fish. So we're rarely meeting those total recovery goals when you combine hatchery and wild fish for what should just be our wild fish numbers. Yes?
What year was the Lonesome Larry?
Oh, that was in the 90s.
Oh, the 90s? Oh.
Yeah. I don't know the exact.
Remember how fast that was, 95 or 96.
I was born in 93. I wish I was around to have the Lonesome Larry era.
We always talk about the year when we only had one. Yeah. You know, Lonesome Larry.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, you know, I'm sure you guys are all thinking, like, what the heck is killing the fish? And so I'll get into a little bit of that. And I'm first going to walk you through a very basic, like, elementary level of salmon steelhead life cycles, and then we'll get into a little bit about how our managers are using tools and indicators to understand survival throughout the system. So again, very, very basic, and you can laugh at these graphs because some of them are pretty funny. But you know, our fish are born in high quality, you know, usually central Idaho, mountain streams, often wilderness areas. Think about tributaries in the middle fork of the Salmon, the upper Limhi, really, really unique rivers, high quality habitat, away from a lot of the human development and, you know, any sort of other pressures that are put on them. So really, really great habitat that we have in central Idaho. Our smolt emerge out of the gravel after a year, and they then begin their migration out of Idaho. They will usually ride the waves of spring flow, spring runoff out of the state, and they're basically met at Lower Granite Dam. So these fish will travel, you know, if you take a Limhi smolt that comes out of the gravel, matures as a smolt, gets flushed all the way down the Salmon River, all the way from the Limhi, all the way to the Salmon River, all the way to the Snake River, and then they are flushed out of our state. And the first thing that they really encounter is Lower Granite Dam, that uppermost dam on the Snake River. So then our smolt will go through the hydro system. So they'll go through four dams on the Snake and four dams on the Columbia. And the way that they do that is they'll either travel over the top as part of the spring spill operations, That is the most favorable thing for them. They can go through juvenile bypass systems, which has a little bit of mortality, but is better than going straight through the turbines. That is the worst case scenario for them, and there's a significant amount of mortality there associated with that. So they'll go through each of those dams, spill over the top, hopefully, and then get through Bonneville Dam, and they're smooth sailing from there. They'll spend some time in the estuary and near shore to kind of acclimate themselves to getting flushed out in the ocean, and then they'll spend a significant amount of time in the ocean, depending on the species, between 1 and 4 years out in the ocean. Tremendously important time for these fish. They'll put on about 99% of their biomass during those years out in the ocean. Really amazing that these fish are able to, you know, leave Idaho as a 4-inch smolt and then come back as a 20-plus pound, you know, spring, summer, Chinook. It's just remarkable. And that's largely relying on the ocean. So really cool. So then on their return, after, you know, all that time in the ocean, they just basically flip that and reverse the course. So they'll return from the ocean, go through the hydropower system yet again. They'll traverse 4 dams on the Columbia and 4 dams on the Snake. One thing that is aiding adults that are returning back through the hydro system is fish ladders. So those are for adult fish, not for the smolt that we're talking about. But yeah, the adult fish all have fish ladders on each of the dams to help them travel back up. Then they will be home free in Idaho, and they'll return to their natal streams and hopefully reproduce so we can generate the next cycle. One thing that managers really rely on is a ratio called small to adult. And you know, we can look at overall fish return numbers, but that's really just a snapshot in time. So this small to adult ratio is really giving us an accurate read on the health of our stocks overall over a long-term period. So we can have, you know, just spikes in the population 1 year, but that doesn't necessarily trend towards actual recovery of a species. So we have to look at multiple years, multiple factors, and that's where the smolt to adult ratio comes in. And you can easily think of this as a percent. So as for every 100 smolt that leave Idaho, how many return to Idaho as adults is that percentage? We only need to have about 2 adults returning for every 100 smolt that leave to replace and sustain that population. So obviously anything above that 2% is ideal. The Columbia Basin Partnership goals, as I kind of thrown in there earlier, identifies a range of 4 to 6% as healthy and harvestable and trending towards true abundance. So, you know, anything less than 2% is indicating population level decline. 2% is kind of that replacement stock, and then 4 to 6% is anything above, and that's really good to see. So SARs, they encompass several years, account for many hazards, directly determine population resilience and adult numbers returning to Idaho. So I'll get into this. This gets a little bit complicated again, but I'll try to be brief on this and not to confuse too many people. But these two graphs are correlated. The bottom graph is smolt to adult ratios from the 1960s to about today. That bottom dotted line right here is that replacement population SAR, 2%. And that top line is the 6%, the true abundance. The dam construction era ended in around 1973, and as you can see, generally we are below that 2% SAR since the dam construction era. There's just a handful of years that have spiked above it, but they quickly returned below that dotted line, and we certainly are not even beginning to be close to that 6% goal, which is that population abundance. And this top graph shows that each year that we get further and further away from a replacement population, which is actually indicated by that zero on that on that left side of the graph, the survival rate is zero is that replacement population. Each year that we get below the 2% SAR, the harder it is for us to actually recover population. We're digging ourselves further and further into a hole the year and, you know, year in, year out, where we have these low fish returns. So like you said, even when we see these quick spikes, like in 2010, 2011, that's not actually getting us to where we want to be, and it's not actually trending towards recovery. We're still well below replacement populations in the long term. So I think it kind of paints a good picture that, you know, we see a lot of this in the news, and especially this year, it's like, oh, fish returns are up, everything's great, but that's not necessarily true when we're thinking about a recovery of a species. Yeah.
Just out of curiosity, is there kind of any explanation for why those spikes are that can be usable in terms of saying like, hey, what contributed to that we can utilize?
Yeah. A lot of it is ocean conditions. You know, we are entering in, the last few years have been pretty terrible for ocean conditions, and our populations have really reflected that. We've kind of entered into a little bit more favorable ocean condition years, and we'll see that. But again, it's I'll get into a little bit of that in just a bit, but a lot of it is ocean conditions. There has been some changes in river management decisions through the years. They've experimented with more spill that aids in smolt actually surviving through the hydro system better. We tried barging for a number of years, smolt, and that had some short-term success and had some longer-term implications. So there's a lot of things that are being tweaked. I'd say the major contributor to that is ocean conditions. Because everything else is kind of staying the same with the dams in place here. But I'll get into a little bit of it more and hopefully answers more of your question.
It's kind of good to know too, Garrett, just supplement for that question, because I know that I was very curious in the same thing. There are umpteen rabbit holes for specific periods of time that you can go down, that there are very good tangible data points for certain periods of time specifically for those that you can dive into the numbers for, like, oh, this year, why is that? Backtrack 2 years when they went out to sea, what was happening with your client, et cetera, et cetera. It's all there, but you can sort of look at those trends and categories as chunks within their own and break those down, and there's generally very tangible related data to that. I had a very personal quest for that myself, so it's there. Okay. It's tough to summarize in one big statement, but they are there specific to those trends and time.
Our boss Brian Brooks always says, before, I should have said this before I started the presentation, he said, this will be confusing. This is the, you know, if this all happens, this would be the largest species recovery effort ever that has been completed in the whole world. You know, this is an enormously complex topic, and there are so many rabbit holes that everybody can go down, and it's just really tough. I'm only scraping just the very top surface of this, so they're all great questions, and we're still, you know, we have questions every day that we need to research into, but yeah, thanks for that. So I'll get into a little bit of how Idaho's fish, Snake River stocks, compare to other rivers in the Columbia River Basin. This is an example for wild spring Chinook. Again, measuring off that smolt to adult ratio. And as you can see, these examples show wild Chinook SARs at 2.5 to 3 times higher downriver when you compare them to Idaho stocks. The John Day River, which those fish traverse over three dams, have about a 3.5% SAR. Return to Bonneville. Yakima River, four dams, 2.4%. Again, still a sustainable and slightly growing population. But then you get all the way up in the Snake River Basin in Idaho, and our SARs have been below 1%, you know, 0.9, 0.8. And so that is representing a declining population. So we'll get into a little bit of what exactly is killing our fish, what causes are natural, what we can change and tweak. And so this is a very quick read of that. This bar graph will represent about 100% of fish mortality for spring and summer Chinook. And this example is for Limhi River spring summer Chinook. And what we can tweak is in red here. So as they leave the gravel, they mature in smolt, and they will get flushed down all the way to Lower Granite Dam. There's about a 29% mortality on their outward journey from Idaho. From there, the remaining population will then go through the hydro system, will wipe out half of those remaining fish that are trying to get out to the ocean. Those fish will then mature. Sorry, that's too much red in there. There should be a little sliver there. Those fish that actually make it out to the ocean and mature as adults, it's surprising, you wouldn't believe it, but there are actually very little, if any, spring chinook that are harvested out in the ocean for Idaho stocks. There's a certain amount of commercial fishing that's done on fall chinook, but springers, there's really not much of an impact from ocean fisheries there. And then the remaining about 98% of those fish will actually die on the ocean due to ocean conditions. Like I said, it's a huge, huge mortality contributor. We were on the Governor Salmon work group, and a lot of this discussion on ocean conditions came up. And one of the fisheries managers just said, it is a huge contributor to mortality, but it's a consistent contributor to mortality. Good ocean condition years will maybe kill 98% of our fish. Bad ocean condition years might kill 99% of our remaining fish. So it is a large contributor to mortality, but it is a consistent source of mortality.
Is that ocean conditions largely predation, or is it global ocean temperature warming?
It's like a trophic whole deal, because when you've got, it starts out with, you know, warmer water just off the coast, and then you've got, you know, it just basically goes up the whole system. For there's less prey availability. Some of those fish will actually, you know, encounter some really significant temperatures as well. And it's kind of a trophic level of response. So this tiny little sliver, which you probably can't even really see due to my bad painting here, this little sliver is the remaining fish that come back and get to the lowest dam, the bottom of the dam. So this is our, these are returning adults that are trying to get back to Idaho. And if you blow up that little tiny sliver right there, you blow up this next slide, this is as they expanded. So this is our return population. For spring and summer chinook, sea lions can wipe away between 15 and 30% of our returning populations. They really hang out at Bonneville Dam and just gorge themselves some years. It's pretty it's entertaining, but also not fun to see. Yeah. The hydro system mortality on their way up through the system has a significantly less impact when you compare it to their migration out as smolt. Like we said, 50% of the remaining fish that make it out of Idaho are wiped away from the hydro system. Here, because of fish ladders, about 16% mortality, which is about 2% per dam. We're looking at a total of 8 dams. So less of an impact, but still an impact total. There's an incidental take on sport fishing and in-river commercial fishing that does occur. That's generally about 3% or less. And then this is kind of the other question that managers have kind of scratched their head on. There's an amount of pre-spawn mortality that we can't really quantify. And that was, again, kind of a question that was raised in the Governor's Salmon work group. But there is some pre-spawn mortality occurring. And then what is remaining is our spawning population, our sexually mature and hopefully paired up spawning population. So when you put this in perspective, again, this bar represents 100% fish mortality. That little tiny sliver on the very end, and often this is the conversation that we focus on and get roped into, is that little sliver accounts for all tribal harvest, all sport fishing harvest, and all sea lion harvest combined. So you put this in perspective, we have a lot of things that are contributing to the death of a lot more fish than these three things that we often focus on. So when we're looking at the biggest impacts, just a quick recap, obviously the hydro system. The water transport time is one of the main contributors to mortality. If it's not just going through the turbines, it's actually the amount of time that they spend in the hydro system. Historically, these fish spent only about a week, about 7 days, to get out of Idaho and out to the ocean. These days it can take 20 to 40 days because of significant slack water systems that we've created. Fish used to actually, you know, ride out to the ocean with their head upstream and actually ride that flow out. Now they have to traverse through significant reservoirs. If you've gone to Portland, you see it all. And it's really a hard time out there for little fish. They're then subject to, you know, a lot of predation, smallmouth bass and walleye and terns. The longer they stay in that system, the more likely that they are to suffer impacts of that. So the quicker we can get them out of the ocean, the better. Obviously, hydro system has a large impact. Ocean conditions, again, large impact, but a consistent one. Obviously, we're seeing impacts from climate change. We're really gonna have to take a hard look at that in the future. Significant impacts to the Northwest as a whole. And then, you know, habitat is also identified as a limiting factor. Thankfully, we have a lot of very, very good habitat in Idaho, and we've done a remarkable job of doing upper basin habitat restoration improvement projects. Idaho's done a phenomenal job with that. There's still more to do, but we still have a considerable amount of habitat when you compare it to other systems. So again, just to recap, what does the science say that can get us to that recovery SAR, that 4-6% Columbia Basin Partnership goal? It's pretty obvious that we need to take a holistic approach. We can't just focus on killing more sea lions. We can't just focus on sport fishing harvest. We need to take this holistically. Water transport time and power ice interactions are identified as the largest contributor of mortality when you're looking at the sheer numbers of smolt that are flushed out of Idaho as compared to others. And you know, we can do things like tweak the hydro system, we can manage predators and habitat. It's a little bit tough to tweak things like climate in the ocean though. So there are things that we can do, there are levers that we can pull that can actually reverse the course of these fish. And these things that, you know, identified, it's the hydro system, predation, habitat. We can't really manage the ocean as much as I'd like to. So I'll switch gears really quick and get into a little bit of the Bonneville Power Administration. It was formed in 1937 to provide electricity to the Northwest at cost. BPA markets and delivers power generated at 31 of their sources. That is dams, solar, nuclear, you name it, they're invested in it. And part of their power portfolio is the lower four Central dams. The lower four collectively produce about 5-7% of the total energy in BPA's portfolio. And they're a little bit unique compared to other mainstem Columbia dams in the fact that these on the Snake River or Run the River dams, they provide little to no water storage capacity and you know, don't have reservoir storage. But it's important to note that they do have value. They help with baseload power. They have other ancillary benefits, such as, you know, the Lewiston Seaport, the furthest inland seaport in the West, and shipping benefits to that, and also some recreational value. So I'm not saying they don't have value. There's a value there today. You know, because I got into this a little bit earlier, but because of the construction of the federal hydropower system, and BPA and the subsequent loss of our salmon steelhead fishing opportunity, Congress passed the Northwest Power and Planning Act in 1980, and that basically made BPA the piggy bank for salmon mitigation. So they said that the system must now not harm salmon, and you must now fund operations that will mitigate for the loss of our fish. So, you know, with the competing markets, and the onboarding of wind and solar, and the obligation to mitigate for the loss of these species, BPA is now grappling with keeping power rates low. In certain instances, they are definitely not the cheapest on the market at this point. In the past, they have sold excess power to California to keep costs low for the primary customers, That's, you know, Oregon, Washington, Idaho, and some Montana. But California has not been buying that because of all the rapid onboarding renewables that they've been seeing. So BPA is somewhere in the realm of charging $36 per megawatt hour. Competitors have been as low as $22 per megawatt hour, and it's causing quite a bit of discrepancy there. And these power bills have been increasing over the past decade or 2 decades, and that's largely tied to mitigation costs for fish. It's estimated, we have a good friend that's on the board of a rural electric co-op in Central Idaho, and says that it's estimated that Central Idaho BPA ratepayers pay about 30% of the monthly power bill to these fish that a lot of times we're not able to fish for. So a significant amount of power bill every month to mitigate for these fish. BPA is also in a little bit of trouble because they are $15 billion in debt, and they've been making federal treasury payments by extending out other debts. And the federal borrowing cap was at $7.7 billion. Last year was bumped up another $10 billion, so they have more spending authority. But it just painting the picture that we are spending a lot of money. BPA is in debt, and ratepayers are largely on the hook for that. BPA spends anywhere from $780 to $800 million a year in fish mitigation. So ratepayers in total have spent about $18 billion towards fish recovery efforts. And as these fish continue to decline, reversing the trend and mitigating for the loss of these fish just becomes greater and greater. One issue with BPA is that they really have no congressional oversight on their spending. Other quasi-federal power entities like Tennessee Valley Authority actually does have a board and have congressional oversight, but a lot of these decisions are not looping in Congress on these decisions, so it's really kind of scary that it's falling under just one head. So the Columbia River System Operations EIS, I want to touch on, which is another area of uncertainty for all of us in the Northwest. This was a document that was finalized in 2020. It ended up in court the next day. But this was the intent behind it is a court mandated study because the past 7 Columbia River System Operations plans have failed to recover fish, and they've all ended up in court, and the federal agencies that are responsible for the operation of the hydropower system have lost in court. That's the BPA. And so they have gone back to back in court and lost. And it's just saying that we are doing harm to these fish, we're not doing enough, we must do something different. And so for the first time ever in 2020, a judge mandated that in the CRSO document, the agencies must analyze dam breaching in their study. They don't have to pick it necessarily, but they actually have to disclose the impacts and then also the benefits of dam breaching to our fish. So federal agencies did not pick an alternative that was that included dam breaching. They just mandated that we spill more water over the dams, do some more habitat work. But I think that these numbers just show no matter how much money we throw at this, we cannot recover the species with the cards that are dealt right now. So one important thing though is that for the first time those federal agencies did acknowledge that if we did breach those lower 4 sink river dams, if we did breach those lower 4 sink river dams, that could get us above that 4% SAR. This is BPA's own scientists telling us that.
Okay, now when you say breach those dams, what does that mean?
I'll get into that very, very, very soon. Okay. But it would basically be creating a new channel, a new river system, a free flowing river system by removing the earthen portions of those dams and creating a free flowing river system.
So that would give the smolt an alternative route that's instead of going through so much still water.
That's right. Yeah, we would create, you know, current and an actual river again instead of just a series of reservoirs. So I'll get into it a little bit more, but I'm happy to kind of go into it a little bit more at the end there too. So the CRSO I guess I just wanted to touch on the fact that first time federal agencies have acknowledged that dam breaching can recover Idaho's fish in the long term. But it's pretty obvious that with BPA and other partnering federal agencies making the calls, any decision that is made through this process is going to be too narrow of a scope to actually address every single issue. It's not going to fix the ongoing financial situation that BPA is facing, and it's just going to force us to be in this endless cycle where we're picking winners and losers. So we're having poor salmon returns. We're getting caught up in this endless litigation that's leaving, you know, shippers and ratepayers in uncertainty, because if a judge can go in and mandate, oh, just go ahead and spill more water, and that's a cost to ratepayers, and that they have to pick that up. And so there's this regional uncertainty that that all of us you know, are experiencing, and it's pretty obvious that we're going to actually need an act of Congress to fix this and bring everybody that is involved and has a say in the game to actually bring them along and prevent our fish from becoming extinct and getting the things that we currently benefit from the hydropower system in if those dams are breached. So, just a quick recap, status quo obviously is not working. We're in that endless cycle. Science says that there's four too many dams for us in the way of Idaho's fish. We spent $18 billion largely on the backs of ratepayers, that BPA ratepayers in particular. That $18 billion has gone to habitat work, more spill, predator management, everything. We've thrown as much money as we could at this problem without actually doing the one thing that we're supposed to do, is reverse the curve and recover these fish. So Northwest really hasn't left the courtroom since the CRSO came out, and that again, like I said, could leave us in this uncertainty where a judge could mandate so many things that the Snake River system is too expensive to operate. If that day comes, there's certainly no certainty that leaders would look after all sectors. You know, they could leave Palouse farmers to have to figure out grain transportation for themselves. And so that's where Congressman Simpson has really come in and tried to form a dialogue on a Northwest solution for all. So, like I said, Representative Simpson dropped this Columbia Basin Initiative and Columbia Basin Fund in early 2020, focusing on certainty, security, and viability for the Northwest. It's really impressive. We did a fly-in to Washington, D.C. with 11 community leaders and along the Clearwater, Snake River, and Sand River Basin. We took a lot of these leaders, some outfitters, we flew to D.C. and we saw the commitment that Representative Simpson has given to this. His wall in D.C. is covered with the Columbia River system and ideas, and it's just, there's chicken scratch all over it. And he's conducted, I think he said, over 400 meetings with stakeholders to try to formulate a plan for the Northwest. And what he released is this $33.5 billion, the B concept, which is the centerpiece action being the removal of the lower four Snake River dams and replacing the benefits that they provide today. So, $33.5 billion is quite a bit of money, and I'll break this down by just a few sectors here. So for the power sector, obviously there'd be a loss of power with the removal of lower Snake River dams, but you know, we have shown with the onboarding renewables that we can replace that power. It's not a significant portion of BPA's portfolio, but it is essential to replace that power. So we're not experiencing, you know, any loss of power. So Simpson's plan injects about $10 billion into energy replacement. That's firm energy, firm power replacement. That could be a renewable source, that could go to battery storage, small modular reactors, pump storage, you name it, it could be on the table. There's also money in there for increased transmission capacity, which a lot of these communities are trying to look at some more. But it's really important to see that these must be constructed and online and serving a benefit prior to any breach action in this plan. So that's really a centerpiece of his plan. So giving some certainty to those power, power producers and ratepayers, and EPA. In addition, there's a 35-year moratorium on Endangered Species Act, Clean Water Act, related litigation tied to the remaining dams in place. There are some, you know, concerns that I think the conservation community does have with a 35-year moratorium on any sort of protections that we could fall back on. But it is, again, it's all about coming to the table and understanding everybody's needs and compromise. So there's a 35-year moratorium on those on the related litigation. In addition, there's an automatic license renewal for all the major Columbia Basin dams. That's a significant thing to the power sector. Idaho Power spent decades trying to relicense the Hell's Canyon complex. They spent three times as much money trying to relicense those dams as they did to construct them in the first place. Wow. So an automatic relicense would be huge for the power sector. And again, it's kind of a, you know, everybody come to the table and try to figure out the most certainty for their sector. And for BPA, BPA ratepayers, again, have no certainty on the future of their power bills with increased fish mitigation costs over the past decade. So Simpson recognized that, and he would basically remove BPA from direct fish mitigation responsibilities and cap a $600 million payment per year split between the states of Idaho, Washington, Oregon, and they could choose what they prefer to do for their fish mitigation and their habitat and recovery efforts. So that's a cap number, $600 million. Like I said earlier, BPA is spending between $780 to $800 million a year right now, and that ceiling, there's no ceiling there. So remove BPA from that direct tie to fish mitigation, just be forced to send over that direct payment to the states where they could do what they want with it without their hands tied. That could still fund hatchery operations, habitat improvement projects, like I said. They would cover what we need. Here is a map of all of the dams that could be automatically relicensed. So a significant portion of the Columbia Basin that could be relicensed, and those Snake River dams are in red, which would be removed. Briefly touching on the farming and transportation side of things, a sector that could be impacted from removal of the Snake River dams. You know, barging via the Snake River is often touted as the most affordable way to get grain to market from the Palouse Prairie out to the ocean and into China. However, that system is largely affordable due to reliance on taxpayers for the upkeep of the river channel. Those services used to be covered by a barge tariff, and that no longer actually covers the cost. It's about $24 million a year for operations and maintenance to ship via the Snake River. So, you know, though river shipping has declined overall the last 30 years, there's still about 95 million bushels of wheat that are barged to the lower Snake River corridor every year. So, again, significant reliance on the Snake River still for Palouse and Kansas Prairie farmers. So, with a restored river, barging via the Snake River would no longer be an option and would need to be addressed. Those barges just could not get all the way up to Lewiston. So Simpson's plan could provide $3.6 billion in restructuring the Snake River transportation over to rail. That would be a rail line that could go from the ports to build out some ports and all the way down to Tri-Cities, where they could then enjoy the benefits of the river again. So there's a concept that Simpson throws in for an agricultural transport trust, which he says, if we inject that $3.6 billion into a trust next year, we could end up with $5 billion in 2030 when the dams could actually be breached and all this infrastructure could be in place. That could amount to about $188 million annual shipper annuity that's protected into perpetuity. And so that could be available for these farmers and actually could make shipping via rail and then at the Tri-Cities via river more affordable than it is today he kind of floated this thing called certified barge grain that could bring almost $2 a bushel premium if he puts this $3.6 billion into a trust. So these are just ideas that he has. He's had meetings, countless meetings to try to keep everybody whole in this situation. There is a little bit of irrigation needs that would need to be addressed as well. And there's about a $750 million budget to reconfigure the irrigation, drill deeper wells, get longer pipes from some of the acreage that is irrigated from Ice Harbor, Rosedale on the system, so make sure it's compatible with the free-flowing river. Lewiston and Clarkston obviously would see a significant change if those dams were removed. And so Simpson is recognizing that and offering $150 million to waterfront restoration and also floating a new economic sector, which would be a Snake River Center for Advanced Energy Storage that would focus on developing large-scale storage methods for renewable energy generation. That could be $1.25 billion that you could invest in the Lewiston area. So it could be a huge economic opportunity if they wanted it. There is an amount of just overall compensation funds due to the loss of recreation and tourism and adjustments to the new free flowing river state. That's about $875 million. And then there's also this theory that we could make a Lower Snake River National Recreation Area. There's a number of main rapids that are currently underwater right now that could be revived, and that could be a tremendous recreational opportunity and destination for many folks. But again, just ideas that he's got and asking folks to come to the table. And most importantly for us, is that it gives viability to our fish. There's about a $4 billion budget to breach those dams, remove the earthen berms, about $400 million to address some sediment concerns, and $600 million a year for continued mitigation and restoration efforts. So science is really clear. EPA's own analysis and the latest CRSO said that breach is the only way that we can get our fish back into abundance. And they said that we could increase in-river survival by as much as 45%. We could decrease the powerhouse interactions that they encounter by as much as 75%. And we could increase our SARs to that healthy and abundant number. CRSO said that with the breach option, our Snake River Chinook could go to 4.3% SAR, and our Snake River Steelhead could go to 5% SAR. So significant boost in our fish numbers over the long term. It's an opportunity, and I think that's what Simpson is framing it as. It's an opportunity that we feel is wise for the Northwest to take a new step into, and to have these conversations, and to actually take what is being offered on the table, and to encourage everybody to come to the table and really work on a path forward that leaves everybody in a better place than we are today. And I just want to recognize that $33.5 billion is a lot of money. That's no getting around that, but it actually may prove to be a bargain in the end when we're thinking about what it would cost for out-of-pocket dollars for fish recovery and future unknown costs for ratepayers and stakeholders. So this $33.5 billion is kind of the holistic approach that's needed, and if we do nothing, we're really entering into a dark time of uncertainty for the whole Northwest. So I think it's an opportunity that we can move away from coming in the cycle of fish versus farms, and we can move into a system that we can allow us to replace those services and supply with federal dollars without placing the burden solely on our ratepayers in the Northwest. And it's an opportunity to actually bring our fish back in a meaningful way. And that is really important for us when we're in these riverside communities. It's, again, an identity for these communities. And so it's a really, really important thing. The concept, would obviously bring the fish back, maintain the agricultural legacy. It could honor commitments to tribes that we have not fulfilled in decades, and again, strengthen local economies in the Northwest. So that's a very, very brief overview, and there's a lot of information, but I just want to open it up, you know, and answer any questions they have, but that's what we got for you.
So these are, again, the four St. River dams, so the fish still need to have to get through the four, or is it six, Columbia River
four
dams, but because the data indicates that they're making it through to the Yakima system, and we're going to John Day, that we think they'll make it.
Science is pretty clear that there are four too many dams in the way of Idaho. We can, those fish are incredibly resilient, and the sheer production will allow these fish return in replacement population numbers through a certain amount of dams, and that's about four right now. But when you get to being above four and upwards of eight, it's pretty obvious there that there's just too many dams in the system. So it's a really interesting, I love this graph because it just really paints a very clear picture. You know, it's important to note that the John Day River fish are experiencing the same river conditions as our Idaho fish, right? The John Day fish are experiencing a lot of the same harvest out in the estuaries as well, and yet our fish are returning at significantly lower SARs.
I think it's an integral part of this conversation, looking at this map, which I think is one of the coolest parts of this entire kind of campaign presentation, to look at the opportunity of where behind that second corridor of dams in the Snake River, and looking at the opportunity for habitat and protected spaces for spawning to occur in such high probable return numbers that exist in Idaho because of the federally protected land that they're within. That is there's a certain quality separation of that habitat that is behind that second chasm of lower Snake River dams that doesn't necessarily have that same breakout and availability to remove another dam somewhere. You know, there's a certain release that exists with that particular area.
So is this plan need to go through the Idaho legislature to start actually happening?
I just wanted it to be an informal thing of like next steps and where we are today. You know, Simpson dropped this some time ago now, and I think he got the response that he expected, and he knew that there was going to be work to be done to bring other federal delegates on board. A couple of delegates have shown some interest. Earl Blumenauer from Oregon has shown some interest in kind of making a bipartisan effort. He's a Democrat from a Portland area, teaming up with a Republican. That's really interesting. And then, you know, Senator Patty Murray, I think, has some interest in that. Her and Governor Inslee have released a report that says, yes, we do need to breach the dams. And they kind of came to the same conclusion that Simpson's plan did. They said, yeah, we need to breach the dams, we need to do it soon, but we just can't do it until the replacement services are in place. And we're like, well, yes, that's actually Simpson's plan right there. So let's jump on that work. But to answer your question, it would be an act of Congress, the federal, you know, it would be a federal delegation that would decide on that. Would not go through our state legislature by any means.
So it's a federal
it's a solely federal issue because of how the just how the Northwest Power Act and all sorts of federal programs were actually implemented through an act of Congress. It would take, you know, the building of the dams actually took an act of Congress, so a movement would actually take it.
So we were very closely tuned in to these recent midterms.
Okay, so how many years do we have before we reach extinction?
Yeah, that's a good question. So the Nez Perce tribe, and you're probably gonna know these numbers better than me, did a study that they released last year that I think it was like 47% of Idaho's fish are at a quasi-extinction level, meaning that in the next, how many years is it?
I can't can't remember what the time, what the time was.
It's less than 50 years.
Yeah.
That 47% of our stocks could be at risk for extinction. You know, we've heard, I think Simpson says, you know, we've got 20 years, and that's really not that long when you're thinking about fish that are, you know, 4 or 5 years old. That's just a few cycles. I think that it's important to note that these fish are incredibly resilient. They have shown us that they can rebound. They are really unique in the fact that they have, say, the middle fork of the salmon has multiple strains within that run that they're able to pass on genetics through all sorts of environmental impacts. So it's not just one strain in the middle fork of the salmon. There are dozens of different strains that can really speaks to the resilience of those fish. So we've, you know, I think the Elwha is a great example that those fish were beating their noses up against the Elwha dams for, you know, however long it was, over 50 years. Yeah. And those fish responded incredibly. And those fish are now in habitat that they have not experienced in 100 plus years. So we've shown that, you know, those fish have shown us that if we give them the space to thrive, they will come back in numbers. But if we continue on the trajectory that we are now, we might only have a few more generations left for a wild fish. We can keep pumping the rivers full of hatchery fish, but again, that doesn't actually get us to a recovering population of wild fish.
We have another question about hatchery fish. So, okay, so where do they get their hatchery stock?
Each hatchery is a little bit different, but there's integrated brood and there's separate brood, but some of them are put up through actually getting that brood stock back from hatchery returns. They'll remove a number of hatchery fish and just, you know, basically respawn those again. There are an amount of wild fish that I believe they can use as integrated brood for, I think, conservation populations as well to try to increase diversity in there. But a lot of it is reliant on actually those hatchery fish coming back up the system. And that's, again, going to the steel that occurred in 2019. We didn't even have enough fish to spawn fish in our hatcheries to provide some conservation, let alone provide some recreational opportunity.
So you collect them, you spawn them, and then you hatch the eggs at the hatcheries, and then you release the fry. So you release them in different rivers, so then the smolt can make their way back to the ocean.
That's right. Yeah, they'll release a smolt in the spring, oftentimes, and each of those smolt will have a pit tag in it, and they can track the fish throughout the system. Each time they go over a dam, they'll get pinged and they'll have a number, and they can track that throughout the whole system and see.
And then when they return, they ping coming back up, and so you see.
Yep. We release about 10 million smolt every year.
And how many do you feel come back a year or 2 years later?
For the projected returns this year, we've got, I should have looked it up today, what we're projecting.
I don't remember the volume of return for individual, including hatchery fish, but I do think it's important to note before we go too much further that the return rates for hatchery fish are significantly less than wild fish. So the proportions that we are producing and releasing these smolt by mandate of Northwest Power Council, we are producing these fish at such an increasing rate, but because of their extraordinarily low return rates, because of the poor genetics of hatchery fish, they're successfully returning at such a low rate that we're actually not seeing any volume increase in this whole return. So I do think that's important to note before we get too far away.
So what would happen if we took these smolt instead of releasing them far, far away rivers and just taking them like past dams and releasing them over there? They would only return to that spot?
Yes.
They wouldn't keep trying to get swim up the dams?
And we've tried barging around dams, and they show that there's some mixed success around that. There's an amount of like delayed mortality in there that they didn't account for. And so fishing games tried, like, can we just go around the dams and release? And I think they've come to the conclusion that it's not really a measurable success. So yeah, it's a tough one. people have suggested salmon cannons, we've run through every single possible
option,
but a free river at this point.
So kind of one point I want to clarify, and then I secondly have a question. So make sure I'm understanding you correctly. You're saying the primary dams that they're looking at to breach are the ones on the Snake, not the ones on the Columbia, because the habitat that would be created by removing those would be better than whatever habitat would be created from moving the ones on the Columbia. Is that what you're saying?
So it's the reason we focus on the Snake, those four Snake River dams, is just solely because of the dire situation Snake River stocks are in right now.
Okay.
That's again, fish from salmon, the Clearwater, all the tributaries of the salmon and Clearwater. These fish are at significantly lower levels as compared to the water of the Columbia River Basin. Mm-hmm. And so that's where we're focusing on the Snake River dams in particular. So under Simpson's concepts, the main St. Columbia dams would get a automatic relicense. So they would in some way be kind of protected under Simpson's plan. There's a lot more going on with those main St. Columbia dams. There's a bigger powerhouse, a bigger energy generator, and a larger, they just have a much larger impact on the system as compared to the Snake River and the Snake River dams, which you can, you know, we've shown that we can actually replace the services with these. So that's really the main focus, that the Snake River dams, that's why it's in question, just because of the sheer impact that they have on Idaho's fish.
Okay, so the second question that I have is Dorshak being considered as part of the dams that would be breached and taken out?
Yeah, it's a good question. It's a great question. They are not under consideration for removal.
Okay.
That's a pretty unique system. And I think Daniel's actually met some old timers in the Clearwater that probably fished the North Fork of the Clearwater back in the day when it was a river, largest beaver on steelhead in the freaking world.
Yeah.
Remarkable fishery. And it was dammed off by Dorshak.
I'm not sure what the license cycle is on Dorshak.
I think it would also get relicensed.
It would also get rid of that.
Is there a reason why they're not being considered as far as you know?
Every fish that returns to Idaho has to go through those four Snake River dams. Not every fish that returns to Idaho has to go through Dorshak.
Okay.
I think that's a large part of it. Just the overall impact that those four dams have on such a large area, it's such a bottleneck that's really the reason they're in focus. Dorshak also has been providing some cold water refugia, cold water releases to the Clearwater River in more recent years that actually is helping some of our fish survive through some of those really, really hot summer months.
Mm-hmm.
I think we should thank our speakers tonight.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
I'm gonna leave a pencil back there. Feel free, you can stand outside and chat as long as you want. It's cold out, or please sign up. And I send out all the emails, I do all of our newsletters and kind of action alerts. If this is something you guys are interested in, or if you just want to stay in contact, to have a local person to ask questions to, that's what we're here for. Sign up, it's free. I don't send you spam, and would love to stay in touch. So I'll just make ourselves available. Thank you guys.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, great.